Anyone who mines cryptocurrency is evil. No, not really. I'm just totally kidding about that, but it seems to kind of sometimes be the stigma involved with crypto mining. I am not by any means a professional crypto miner, and in fact, my mining operation is relatively residential. However, for those looking to get into crypto mining, I do believe that I can provide a little bit of insight about how to do that. Now, I've always been really into computers, and I've always understood the concept of crypto mining, how, you know, a graphics card can take an algorithm, run it constantly, and then, you know, eventually through some magical means you get Bitcoin, right? I totally understand exactly how all that works. Technology, on the other hand, is what I do understand. And how to build a crypto mining rig, how to set it up and get it running is fairly simple, and it's right up my alley. Back in March, I started my crypto mining operation. I started with a single graphics card with one CPU, and I was making under 10 cents a day. Now, since then, I have bought quite a few graphics cards, and I have a total of 5 mining rigs running in my house right now. Building a crypto mining rig is almost exactly like building a computer. The only key difference is that you're going to have multiple graphics cards plugged into the same motherboard, whereas on a normal PC, you'd only have one graphics card. So instead of picking out a motherboard that could do up to 13 GPUs, I settled on a motherboard that could do 6. So the motherboard I settled on was an MSI X470 Gaming Max Plus. And I hope that means something to you. I don't know why they had to add so many things to the end of it. The important things about this motherboard was it used an AMD chipset, which I had already built multiple AMD computers, so I was familiar with the, you know, infrastructure around it. The second thing was that they were very simple to set up. They didn't have any extra special bells or whistles. There was no RGB. There was nothing extra. It was just going to do exactly what I needed it to do. I will say there's, you know, some debate about whether or not buying used hardware from China is a good idea or not. In my experience, I've bought 3 CPUs for my mining rigs from China. They're all Ryzen 3 1200s. And they've all worked perfectly. I have not had a single issue with a single one of them. Now, the reason I bring this up is because that same CPU could cost up to $110, $120 brand new. But if you buy it used on eBay from China, you can pay as little as $76 per CPU. So it could very possibly save you a lot of money, and you could get a return on your investment even quicker. Now, you'll see that as a theme throughout this video. A lot of the decisions I made when picking out hardware were due to budget. I really wanted to make sure that whatever I bought was justified and wasn't anything extra than what I absolutely needed to make these rigs run the best that they possibly could. So each of these rigs has a Ryzen 3 1200 in them. They all have 4 gigs of RAM, and they're all set up exactly the same across the board. Each of them has a combination of 2 Corsair 850-watt power supplies. When getting into the power conversation about crypto mining, it is very important that I say that I am not an expert about this in any way, shape, or form. I would highly recommend you go watch other people's YouTube videos, you read things on forums to make sure that you're not going to make any really dumb decisions that could potentially burn your house down. In general, though, what you'll find is there are some key guidelines that you want to follow in order to make sure that your mining rig is powered safely. The first and most important is the 80% rule. You never want to go over using more than 80% of the power supplied to your computer. You also never want to go over 80% of the power that is supplied to your wall socket that your computer is pulling power from. Now, it can sometimes be difficult to calculate exactly what the wattage is for your mining rig, but you can usually find the wattage for each of the individual graphics cards, add those up, and then add about 100 for the extra peripherals that are plugged in to your motherboard. Now, the next and probably the most important thing for you to remember is to stay clear entirely of SATA power. The SATA cables that come with almost every single mining riser that you're gonna find are terrible. You really need to throw those directly in the trash as soon as you get them. And the reason for that is because your mining riser can pull up to 75 watts of power. However, that SATA pin connector can only deliver up to 50 watts of power. Now, I don't know if you know anything about electricity, but that deficiency is terrible, not only for the riser, but also for the cable. If the cable's trying to pull more than it can deliver, it will eventually heat up, set on fire, and potentially burn your entire house down. There has been a pretty big debate about whether or not Molex power is okay to use for mining risers and for plugging directly in your graphics card. And there really isn't an exact consensus, because While the cable and connector itself can deliver the power needed, it doesn't always deliver that power, and there have been issues with some of these setting on fire and melting, different things like that. So the point I'm trying to make is, in general, if possible, try to stick exclusively to 8-pin connectors directly from your power supply and directly into your graphics card. So what I have for this mining rig specifically is 6 8-pin cables. And each one of these 8-pin cables is run with a splitter on the end. I have 3 on one power supply and 3 on the other. So each power supply is only running 3 graphics cards. On one side of the splitter, we plug the riser in, and on the other side of the splitter, we actually plug the graphics cards in. Now, some of these graphics cards have extra power that they need. They have 2 8-pins or an 8-pin and a 6-pin, and so they need more power. So in order to solve this, sometimes I will use a dual Molex to a 6-pin connector. And that's not necessarily always recommended, and I certainly would not recommend using this as your primary source of power for the graphics cards, but as a secondary source of power for me in particular, it has worked very well. So from there, the only real thing we need to talk about is potentially the rig that you're trying to put all of this hardware on. For a long time, I personally used DIY wooden rigs that I built in my garage with just leftover scraps of wood and some pallet wood that I had laying around. I'll be the first to tell you that I was very proud of how effective these rigs were and how efficient they were as far as space is concerned. Now, unfortunately, I've had to retire the wooden rigs, and the justification for that was that sometimes these 8-pin splitters that I bought will have a tendency to heat up themselves, can melt, and could potentially spark and start on fire. It's not as big of a deal if you have a metal rig, but if you have the DIY wooden rigs that I had, you know, a lot of wood in close contact with this hardware that is constantly heating up could potentially be very dangerous. I went on eBay, I bought myself some metal rigs, and we have switched all of my mining rigs over to complete metal rigs. So initially, when I started mining, I exclusively used Windows, and it worked really well to a certain extent. There were some issues that I had. Obviously, Windows updates has a tendency to constantly restart your machine, which will constantly restart your mining. And unless you're using a software that can tell your mining to automatically start back up on a restart, then you're kind of out of luck until you realize, oh, hey, you know, this machine's not mining anymore. So over time, because of that issue and a couple other issues with Windows, like resetting your graphics card overclocks, I've transitioned the vast majority of my mining rigs over to NiceHash OS. NiceHash OS is not perfect by any means. It can't be controlled exclusively from a web page like some of the other third-party mining softwares can. It also has to be manually configured on a thumb drive before you even plug it into the machine. And on top of all of that, it can be incredibly complicated and difficult to get your overclocks exactly right. And if you get even the smallest thing wrong, then it completely resets all of your graphics overclocks to the default. For me, however, after a little bit of work of getting all of the overclocks set exactly how I wanted them to, it was relatively simple to just plug a thumb drive in, tell the computer to boot to that thumb drive, and then just leave the mining rig alone. It would boot and just start mining by itself. Not only that, it would automatically start mining the most profitable algorithm, which is fantastic if you did not want to have to take the time to figure that out yourself. The only other downside I've seen to NiceHash OS is it has a very, very difficult time assigning overclocks to AMD 5700 XTs. And I have absolutely no clue why. I cannot for the life of me figure out why it does not like that graphics card, but I had to keep that rig in particular on a Windows box just so that I could keep the graphics overclocks applied consistently to those cards. If you have any comments or questions or concerns about anything I'm doing or anything that I could potentially do better or anything that could help you in a future video, please leave those comments, questions, suggestions down in the comment section below. Now, I know this has been more of just like an information dump in case you're wanting to build a crypto mining rig, but if this information did help you in some way, shape, or form, please feel free to subscribe, like the video, and I'll see you guys next time.